So let's play a game. You and I are standing next to this beautifully drawn coin machine, and we have a choice whether or not to insert a coin into the machine or not. And the machine will reward us with something depending on what we, how we insert our coin. So if we both decide to insert a coin, then the machine will reward both of us with two coins. However, if only one of us decides to put in the coin whilst the other just decides, nope, I'll keep my coin, then the person who puts in the coin just loses the coin, and the machine will reward the person that didn't put in the coin with three extra coins. And finally, if we both decide not to put in any coins, then nothing happens. And so, audience, just have a think what you would do. I would just like two people to raise their hand to play a game against me. And here's the payoff table in case you guys wanted to just have a quick think. All right, Martin, you can choose whether to cooperate or not cooperate with me by putting in the coin. Shame, because I hoped one of you would decide to cooperate with me, but turns out he's a bit smart. And because I've also prepared this slide to not cooperate, because I made this slide 2 months ago, and that was my strategy. And so, yeah, we both decided not to cooperate, which is a shame, because none of us actually get anything. So would another audience member like to try and play a game? Yeah. That's a shame, because I also decided not to cooperate again. So in the end, I was hoping that someone would decide to cooperate, but, well, you guys aren't paid actors, so you guys are smart. But so, yeah, we both end up not gaining any coins. So what am I trying to bring here? What is this example? Well, this example is basically a demonstration of a two-player game and how applied game theory can actually make us choose a better strategy that may benefit us more or not. And first, just to start, I believe many of you would probably know what game theory is. However, many people think that game theory is actually quite a hard concept to grasp. And I have to admit that when I first started learning this, I wasn't exactly the guy that could understand all of these complex theories. However, through these examples that I will show you today, hopefully you will realize how interwoven these game theory actually is with our lives, with examples ranging from the Cuban Missile Crisis between the US and the USSR and betraying your friends in a game of Prisoner's Dilemma, which brings me to my first example. As you may all know, the Prisoner's Dilemma game is one of the most famous games in Game Theory, and so today I'll bring forth a more altered version of this. So imagine this. You and your friends have decided to cheat on your Foundation Maths IGCSE exam. I know, a bit stupid, but hear me out. So, but the teacher has just caught you, and they're 99% sure that you have cheated, but they don't actually have sufficient evidence to fully prove that you are a cheater. So they decide to use this method. The teacher puts you into separate rooms, and as the teacher comes to you and asks you this question. So if you decide to confess and pin the blame on the other for being the mastermind, then yeah, great, I will let you free, and your friend who you pinned your blame on will be suspended indefinitely, or otherwise known as expelled. However, if your friend also does it and pins the blame on you, then now I have sufficient evidence that both of you cheated. So now you both will get suspended for a whole year. However, if you both decide to remain silent and not pin the blame on each other, then the teacher really has no choice but suspend you for 3 months. So I'm not that great at how many months you should be suspended for, but that's just an example. And so have a think. What would you do in this case without being able to communicate with your friend? You're sitting alone in a room trying to think. The logical thing to do, actually, is to confess. Well, you might think, oh, why is that? If you realize, no matter what your friend does, whether they choose to be silent or confess, it's actually much better for you to confess. As you can see, you would have to be suspended for 3 months compared to zero if your friend stays silent, or you get expelled compared to 12-month suspension if they confess. And so in your mind, you would think, yes, okay, I would confess because that would be the best position for me. I would have the best outcome out of this situation. However, in the not-so-surprising plot twist, your friend will also be thinking the same thing and realizing that, of course, confessing is obviously the best for me in case my friend also decides to confess. And so what happens is that you'll end up in both of you confessing, causing you to both be suspended for 12 months. Oops. But so this example just shows that if we both decide not to communicate with each other, both of us will be suspended for 12 months. And one other thing that we have to realize is that game theory does not only have to be applied to these modern events, such as cheating in an exam. However, it can also be applied back in history. So let's turn our clocks back 60 years amidst the Cold War between two superpowers, as you may know, the US and the USSR. So during this, the infamous 13 days during the Cuban Missile Crisis, the US leader, John F. Kennedy, and the Soviet leader, Nikita Khrushchev, both had their countries on nuclear standby as the world watched the both sides play a theoretical game of chess, where both sides have not made a capture yet, but they have started launching a massive attack on each other to prepare for total world annihilation. However, there has this been this lingering theory during the Cold War, which you may know as mutually assured destruction, better known as MAD. And what MAD basically is that the thought that if one side were to attack the other side would most likely respond and retaliate, which will cause a war that would have seen more casualties in the first week compared to the whole of World War II. And both sides, the US and the USSR, would know that. And basically what MAD prevents that us to do is that in case one side attacks, we know for sure that the other side would obviously respond in order to make it equal. So for this example, we can sort of neglect this attack nothing scenario from both sides. However, you may realize that if both sides decide to attack each other, the world will be destroyed. And compared to if they had just decided to do nothing, it'd be more beneficial because nothing happens. And so both the US and the USSR would have realized this. And so they have implemented a less aggressive approach known as brinkmanship, which is a strategy where they still try and push each other to the brink of a conflict, but once it gets to that critical point, they would just pull back and say, nope, let's go with peace. And so this really comes into play during MAD theory as it ensured that nothing actually happened, even though that it seems like the world was going towards the tangent of total nuclear annihilation. Nothing truly happened. And so this brings me to the point of how communication can actually allow this to this process to be more accelerated. So with communication, we can realize that they can actually just discuss a strategy instead of trying to threaten each other in a mind sort of mind game to reach that nothing zero-zero scenario. And we can see that in real life because during the Cuban Missile Crisis, both John F. Kennedy's brother, Robert Kennedy, and the Soviet ambassador to the US were in secret negotiations throughout the 13 days to come up with a strategy to de-escalate the situation back to pre-Cuban Missile Crisis times. And eventually they came up with an agreement where the Soviets would pull out their missiles from Cuba in a trade for where US would pull out their missiles from Turkey. And through the power of communication, we were able to avoid a war that can have devastated the world 10 times over. And this sort of communication is actually extremely essential, not just for mutually assured destruction, but we can go back to the example of where we had an exam. So imagine that before the exam, before the teacher puts you into separate rooms, you guys could have a talk. You guys would have decided if the teacher does this and this, you'd realize that we shouldn't both confess, as you can clearly see that if we both decided to stay silent, we'd both be suspended for 3 months, instead of if we both confessed, being suspended for 12 months. And so if you knew that beforehand and had discussed a strategy where both of you could have said, okay, let's stay silent, it's the most beneficial for us, then you would have gone with that strategy. When the teacher comes and puts you in separate rooms, both of you would stay silent. And instead of facing 12 months of suspension, you would face 3. And finally, with a final example that I've mentioned at the start, is the coin game scenario. As you may know, my choices that I made at the start, they were made 2 months ago. I had no communication with any of you. I would not have known whether you would choose to cooperate or not cooperate. But had I been able to communicate with a two audience member beforehand, and have we both agreed upon a strategy where we both cooperate, we both have won 2 coins each instead of none. And so this is basically the importance of communication in these game theory scenarios, in these two-player game sort of style, as you can basically come up with better strategies that can give you guys both the best strategy where you can be have a better outcome compared to had you not been communicating with each other. So what three things can we learn from this? The first thing is that, of course, you can obviously just decide to ignore what your friend says and just confess, trying to benefit yourself the most. However, that does have a cost. This is because your friend will also eventually catch on to your strategy that you've implemented and will also use it against you. So basically, from the exam scenario we said at the start, your friend knew that you would also play the confess strategy. So she will also play the confess strategy to out-betray you, and you'd both end up in this confess-confess scenario where you both get suspended for 12 months instead of 3. The second thing to note, that cooperation in most scenarios are actually quite beneficial. As you can see, had we both cooperated in a coin game, we would both get 2 coins compared to had we not cooperated, it would be 0. And just in real life, cooperation is more beneficial as it's usually, as competition is usually lowered, and to avoid us from losing our profit in real life examples, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, one of the most important things that you might have noticed is that communication is essential, whether or not it's a game about, unless it's a game about out betraying each other, but communication in real life is more important, as you basically have an idea of what your opponent would do. So you guys could come up with a better strategy that could benefit both of you, instead of you guys trying to out betray each other and to try and outmaneuver each other, where you'd be worse off compared to if you had communicated beforehand. And so what we just have to know is that communication is absolutely essential unless there's certain circumstances. For example, in a game of chess, communication is obviously not allowed, and you shouldn't be communicating in a game of chess. But in general, in these real-life applications, communication is essential in coming up with a better strategy for all. So we can have a, So we can both be able to be benefited by our choices instead of being out betrayed, and for one side to try and outdo the other side, causing both sides to lose. Thank you very much.